My name is Craig Anderson. I'm the newest member of the UCR board here at the Unitarian Universalist Church in Reston. It's wonderful to see you all here today. Thank you for coming. Whether you're here on Zoom or here in the sanctuary, we're so glad you're here with us today. No matter how old or young you are, wherever you are in your spiritual journey, whoever you love, however you identify, know that you are welcome here. There were no particular announcements today, but I would like to offer a reminder that we have the time capsule out in the East Foyer. Linda Holloway is hoping that we'll fill it up by September to be opened, I think, on the 75th anniversary of the church. So consider bringing something in that will be a surprise for those in the future. Our service today is being led by Denise Kirwan. Denise is a longtime member of our church, where she has served in many capacities. Until very recently, she served as the co-chair of the Social Action and Justice Committee. She's been the chair of our very successful alternative gift market for several years. She has a 22-year-old son and lives in Leesburg with her two dogs. We are very pleased to have Denise here today leading this service, which she has named or entitled, "Who is Edward Everett Hale and What is He Doing in My Hymnal?" We're joined today by our music director, Cynthia Young. David Niemi is serving as the worship associate, and UCR member Phillip Kancianic is our accompanist today. Linda Weaver, the director of religious education, is downstairs with the children, so there's no time for all ages in the sanctuary today, but children are invited downstairs for activities, and there is childcare downstairs as well. I understand there will be some water activities for the kids and some popsicles downstairs this morning as well. We're very pleased to welcome our guest artists this morning, Bella Voce, an a cappella women's ensemble created and directed by Cynthia Young, is here with us today. Welcome. You may remember Bella Voce from their past performances at our church during the height of the COVID pandemic. When our worship services were all online, Cynthia incorporated several of their lovely music videos into our worship services, and we're delighted to have them here today. Jeff Hamlin will be accompanying them on piano as well. Thank you all for participating in today's worship service, and thanks always to our rotating production team of Amelia Turner, Mike Schmidt, David Niemi, and Maggie Mack. And now let us center ourselves for worship. Please consider taking some deep, quieting breaths as we enter our time of worship together and listen to "Will There Really Be a Morning?" with words by Emily Dickinson and music by Craig Hella Johnson, being performed by Bella Voce with pianist Jeff Hamlin.
Thank you for the beautiful music. Our opening words today are from Edward Everett Hale. Life seeks life and loves life. In the opening of a willow's catkin, in the flight of the butterfly, in the chirping of a tree toad or the sweep of an eagle, my life loves to see how others live, exults in their joy, and is partner in their great concern.
Good morning. I would like to offer a personal welcome to my friends in Bella Voce and to Jeff Hamlin, our accompanist. Thank you so much for being here at UU Reston this morning. Our opening hymn today is number 21, For the Beauty of the Earth. Please rise in body or spirit and join us in singing. If you are on home watching on Zoom, the words will be in your chat box.
Today's chalice lighting is adapted from Edward Everett Hale himself. Today, we come together in spiritual community. Together is one of the most inspiring words in the English language. Coming together is a beginning. Keeping together is progress. Working together is success.
Here at UUCR, we have a tradition of singing our covenant together every Sunday. Love is the spirit of this church. The words are in your order of service. I think they will also show up here on the screen and at home in your chat box. If you are visiting us this morning for the first time, please accept this song as our blessing to you. We will remain seated.
Thank you.
was the time in our service when we share our joys and concerns so that no one ever has to hold them alone. If you are joining us remotely this morning, you may wish to light a real or virtual candle wherever you are this morning to mark what is on your heart. As members of the in-person congregation here at UUCR, place stones in the water here in the sanctuary. If those of you at home would like to share what is on your heart today in the congregational chat on the screen, please write to all attendees, and please remember that anything you share will be public. You're welcome to come forward now.
Let us take a moment to join together in a spirit of reflection and prayer. We are grateful for this time to be in community with each other and to reconnect with that place of quiet within ourselves. We hold in our hearts our community's concerns, all those who are struggling or facing trial, and those who need our care. Especially this week, we remember the victims of extreme climate events with tragic consequences happening throughout the world and here at home. As we hold these sorrows and concerns, we also take time to give thanks for our blessings. For the joy of long summer days, maybe some extra time with family and friends, and preparing now for the start of new things, new school years about to begin. We hold with care and love all the joys and concerns shared and all of those that remain in our hearts. Amen and blessed be.
This is a self-funded church, and UUCR relies on the generosity of its members and friends to fund our daily operations and to ensure that the church and its resources are here for us now and in the future. Pledges support our worship and music programs, our religious education program, programs for members and friends, community outreach, and connections to Unitarian Universalism. We now invite you to support the work of UU Reston by making a donation to the collection plate if you're here in the sanctuary, or at the link on the slide and in the chat box. Thank you for your generosity and for your support of our beloved spiritual home.
Faith is the bird that feels the light and sings when the dawn is still dark.
Oh, faith is the bird that feels the light, the bird that feels the light.
If you've been coming to a UU church, any UU church, a month or more, you've undoubtedly heard reading number 457 from our hymnal by Edward Everett Hale, a famous Unitarian minister of the 19th century. I am only one, but still I am one. I cannot do everything, but still I can do something. And because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do the something that I can do. In addition to being a minister, Hale was the chaplain of the United States Senate from 1903 to 1909. You may also have heard the following quip that is attributed to him. Someone asked him, "Mr. Hale, do you pray for the senators?" He replied, "No, I look at the senators and I pray for the country." So you see, nothing's changed. Let's keep those quotes in mind while I go off in a different direction. With a little luck, we'll circle back and it'll all make sense in the end. I'm going to tell you a true story with a little show and tell. We'll see if I learned anything in kindergarten. So my mother had four older brothers. She was the only girl and the baby. The youngest of her brothers, my Uncle Bill, died about 25 years ago. After he died, my cousin Greg asked me if I would like to have a box of letters that he had found. Box of letters. Sure, why not? Maybe there'll be something interesting in there. Here's the box. I want you guys to take a look at it, so I'll walk it around. So, any old-timers notice anything about this box? No old-timers here?
I noticed
Okay, am I the only old timer here? This has nothing to do with the sermon, but this is a box from Woody's, Woodward and Lothrop's, which was a department store in the in D.C. It was a D.C.-based department store that was founded in 1887 and closed in 1995. So that's an old box. So I went through the box. Box has lots of stuff in it. And found various and sundry letters and other pieces of paper dating from 1852 through 1936. There are letters containing information about alfalfa prices in Iowa and my great aunt Helen's trip to Europe for the International Social Workers Convention in the 1930s. Now we should be having a slide up here. There's a 2-franc note. Slide. There we go. Oh, there it's. Okay. 2-franc note issued by the Allied military government for use after the Battle of Normandy. There's an order of service, from the Brighton Congregational Church for October 22nd, 1893, with Reverend A.A. Burley, pastor. If anybody's a fan of American history, Reverend Burley's son, also named A.A. Burley, was a member of FDR's Brain Trust. There's some type of document solely in Arabic. If anybody reads Arabic, let me know. I think it's probably a travel document because you'll find out in a minute why. But anyway, I think it's a travel document. It's got stamps and stuff on it. Then we have, next slide, we have an old type of check. Do we have the next slide? Ah, there it is, okay. It's called a third of exchange. It's apparently an old type of check that was primarily used for international transactions, and there's a letter that goes with it. But what's interesting is, if, I don't know if you can tell up there, it's signed by Daniel Webster, the Daniel Webster. Apparently because he was Secretary of State in 1852, which is the date of the document. All right. So, all very interesting, but nothing earth-shattering, so I put the box on the shelf in my library and forgot about it. So, a few years after I received the box of letters, I was corresponding, for reasons that escape me now, with a man named Peter Colopy, who had written his dissertation on my great-grandfather. My mother's paternal grandfather was George Frederick Wright, who also went by G. Frederick Wright. We have the picture. Handsome guy, right? Handsome guy. Although I'm sure none of you have ever heard of him, he was fairly well-known in certain circles in the late 19th century, and even has a small Wikipedia entry. I guess that's today's claim to fame if you're in Wikipedia. My great-grandfather was both a geologist and a theologian, not an uncommon combination in the late 19th century, although more common in England than in the United States. He attended both Oberlin College and Oberlin Theological Seminary and was a professor at Oberlin from 1881 until 1907. He was particularly interested on his geology side of his interests. He was particularly interested in glaciation and was employed by the United States Geological Survey, which is headquartered right down the road now, to determine the southernmost limit of the glacier's advance in America from New England west to Illinois. And on the table in front, in the middle, I have some hot cellars that he wrote, Man and the Glacial Period, and the Ice Age in North America. There's also, next to them, on this end, his autobiography. Anyway, so, during my correspondence with Mr. Colopy, he said that Charles Darwin had apparently written my great-grandfather a letter. I assume that Darwin would have done so because of my great-grandfather's status as both a scientist and a theologian. Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection, as it is officially known, was an idea that, of course, literally changed the world, but like many new ideas, it was not automatically accepted, especially by the religiously minded. Where would the church, which for centuries had taught that God created everything and where would God himself stand in the face of this new scientific theory? According to Wikipedia, Wright, my great-grandfather, was initially an outspoken defender of Darwin, but later espoused a theistic evolution. In other words, scientific evolution, but with God putting his finger in it from time to time. Back to Colopy's question. Might I have a letter from Charles Darwin to my great-grandfather? Ah, the box of letters sitting on my shelf. I didn't recall anything from Charles Darwin. I thought that that might have made an impression on me, but I would double check. So I went through the box of letters again. I found nothing from Charles Darwin, but did find a long letter from someone named Edward Everett Hale with engraved letterhead. Is it up there now? I can't see the, yeah, okay. Up in the left-hand corner it says, from Edward E. Hale, and then it's got his address, 30 Highland Street, Roxbury, Mass., and it's dated November 9th, 1905. The name rang a bell. By that time, I had started attending the UU Church. I checked my hymnal. Yes, this is the man who wrote that saying, I am only one, but still I am one. I cannot do everything, but still I can do something. And because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do the something that I can do. Here's the letter in the original. Sorry. Well, it's not Charles Darwin, but terrific. This letter will be full of profound philosophical truths, and with a minimum of effort on my part, key issue, would probably make a fabulous sermon. But no, it was not to be. The letter was a long discourse on Native American languages, in particular, a critique of John Eliot's translation of the Bible into Algonquin. Eliot's Bible was the first translation of the Bible into a Native American language and was also the first Bible actually printed in British North America. The letter also discusses James Hammond Trumbull's study of Native New England dialects. Native American languages. I had never heard that my great-grandfather had any interest in that, so I poked around and eventually found out that another Mr. Wright, John Wright, rector of St. Paul's Church in St. Paul, Minnesota, wrote a book about early Bibles in America, with the first chapter devoted to John Eliot's Indian Bible. Apparently, he was the intended recipient of this letter, and Edward Everett Hale had sent his letter to the wrong Mr. Wright. Perhaps that is how the letter has survived to this day. My great-grandfather may have intended to determine who should have received the letter and would have forwarded it on to him. But obviously, my great-grandfather and Mr. Hale must have been acquainted. How could that have been? In addition to being a geologist and a theologian, George Frederick was a congregational minister, first in Bakersfield, Vermont, and starting in 1871 in Andover, Massachusetts, before taking his position at Oberlin. During Wright's time in Andover, Edward Everett Hale was pastor at the South Congregational Church, Unitarian, in Boston, about 25 miles away. I'm assuming that they met during this period through their church connections, although, as we shall see, they had other interests in common. Andover was also home to the famous Andover Theological Seminary, now incorporated into Yale Divinity School, which attracted many famous pastors, although the Andover Seminary was more conservative than the Congregationalists / Unitarians at the time. But perhaps they met there. So there's Hale. Hale himself was born in Boston in 1822. He was a great nephew of Nathan Hale, the Revolutionary War hero who was a spy for the Continental Army and captured and executed by the British. All American school children learn, or at least used to learn, Nathan Hale's famous last words, "I only regret that I have but one life to give for my country." He was just 21 years old at the time of his death. Edward Everett Hale himself graduated from Harvard at age 17 not unheard of in those days. He disliked the teaching methods at Harvard and found the professors to be, quote, 100 years behind the times. Sounds like the typical teenager, right? He subsequently studied privately for the clergy and was instructed by Samuel Kirkland Lothrop, his local minister, and John Gorham Palfrey, both conservative but respected Unitarians. Hale also began a literary career, writing short stories for the magazine Atlantic Monthly, still in print today as The Atlantic. He wrote 18 novels, none of which are especially remembered today, and authored or edited over 60 books, one of which I have here, the one furthest to your left on the little table. This is from a series called Lights of Two Centuries, for which Hale was the editor. This particular volume includes artists, writers, and composers, among others. He came to national literary attention in 1859 with his short story, My Double and How He Undid Me, a comical story of a pastor who hires a double to handle the more boring aspects of his ministry. He is, what, boring aspects of ministry? We'll have to ask Reverend Scott about that. He is most famous for the story, The Man Without a Country, which brought him additional national fame when it was published in 1863 to encourage support for the North during the Civil War. For many years, it was required reading in schools across the country. On the ministry side of the equation, Hale was licensed to be a Unitarian minister at age 20 in 1842. He was pastor of the Church of the Unity from 1846 to 1856 and became pastor of the South Congregational Church, Unitarian, Boston, in 1856 and stayed there for 33 years until 1889. In 1850, when he was only 28, he was invited to address the American Unitarian Association for their 25th anniversary celebration. In 1864, Hale joined Henry W. Bellows, minister of First Congregational Church, New York, now All Souls Unitarian New York, to organize the first national Unitarian conference. The difficulty was in placating the Boston conservatives, who believed firmly in Jesus Christ, with the radicals, such as followers of Ralph Waldo Emerson and Theodore Parker, who did not hold a special place for Jesus. The upshot was to have no statement of creed, but instead a draft constitution. In 1870, Hale was selected to be the Unitarian representative to the Universalist Centennial Celebration. As you may know, the Unitarians and the Universalists did not join forces to become Unitarian Universalists, or UUs, until 1961. In the 19th century, they were two separate entities. As for his personal life, Hale married Emily Baldwin Perkins, granddaughter of Calvinist preacher Lyman Beecher and niece of Harriet Beecher Stowe in 1852. Although Calvinism can encompass a wide variety of views, the Calvinists of 19th century New England were very conservative compared to the more freewheeling Unitarians. So religiously, this was a bit of a marriage of oil and water. Together they had 9 children, 6 of whom survived to adulthood. By the latter half of the 19th century, Hale was one of the most well-known clergymen in the country. Think the Martin Luther King Jr. or Billy Graham of the 19th century. He thought the church should be, and I quote, one of the active social factors in American life, leading to the upbuilding of the community in which it existed. He espoused many social justice issues of the day, including abolition, workers' housing, settlement housing for poor immigrants, and education for African Americans and Native Americans. He was involved in the founding in 1868 of Hampton Institute, now Hampton University in Hampton, Virginia, one of the premier historically black colleges and universities in the United States. He was a proponent of the Chautauqua movement, which encouraged continuing education for adults throughout America, and which still exists today as the Chautauqua Institution in Chautauqua, New York. In his short story, 10 times 10 is 1, he wrote the motto, look up and not down. Look forward and not back. Look out and not in. Lend a Hand, which eventually led to the creation of many Lend a Hand clubs throughout the world. Although the clubs no longer exist, there is still a Lend a Hand Society in Boston. At his death, he was called the best loved clergyman in the United States. This is a statue of him in the Boston Public Gardens, which describes him as a man of letters, preacher of the gospel, prophet of peace, patriot. Biographers cited his, quote, blameless public and private life of moral leadership. But lest you think that he is the UU candidate for sainthood, I should point out that although he was progressive in many ways, he was regressive in others and did not quite lead the life of total moral leadership. Like all of us, he was only human and he was a product of his times. Despite his many progressive social attitudes, he held traditional views on marriage and women and pointedly did not support the women's suffrage movement. Although he espoused education for certain groups, he was against higher education for women and did not allow his only daughter to attend college. He was once asked to dissuade a colleague's daughter from attending Vassar. Years later, he justified himself to her by saying, quote, "You know that I do not much like sending girls to college. I am not sure that you have forgiven me that I advised against your going to Vassar. How terrible you would have been. I believe that you would have worn spectacles." Although he founded the New England Emigrant Aid Society to aid poor immigrants, his reasons for supporting immigrants were problematic. Okay, who was at the bottom of the barrel in the mid-19th century in terms of immigrants? Anybody? The Irish. Okay, my father was from Ireland, so I take this personally. The Irish fleeing the potato famine. Hale wrote a small book titled Letters on Irish Emigration, in which he describes the Irish as undisciplined stragglers, and continues, "I cannot recall any masterwork of art, of science, of politics, of religion, or of letters which the world owes to the Celtic race." So, it gets better. "Such unexplicable uselessnesses such as Stonehenge, such histories as the wretched feuds of Irish chieftains, are the fragments of a race that has done nothing." Okay. So why was he in favor of Irish immigration? Which he was in favor of it. Because Irish immigrants would be on the bottom layer of society, and their inferiority would make the rest of society feel better. And by the way, he was quite the abolitionist. He thought it would be a good idea to send them to Kansas to help keep Kansas territory a free state. As for his blameless private life, he had what we call an intimate relationship that lasted for many years with his assistant, Harriet Freeman, who was 2.5 decades his junior. If his family and biographers were aware of the affair, and it seems to me that it would be pretty hard to hide a 25-year affair, they concealed their knowledge of it. Definitive proof of the affair was not unearthed until the beginning of the 21st century, when his family donated his letters to the Library of Congress. A researcher was able to decipher the uncommon type of shorthand that they used for writing, that he and the assistant wrote many letters back and forth, and they used this uncommon type of shorthand to convey the more juicy aspects of their life. Hale and Freeman also found common spirit in their interests in natural science, including botany, conservation, and geology. So here are the two men. Found a different one. So I've given you a summary of two men from the 19th century, well known throughout the country, and the other well known in his field. And I need to answer my original question, how did they know one another? I originally assumed that it was when they were both clergymen in Massachusetts in the 1870s, perhaps cemented by their mutual interest in geology. But it is equally possible that they originally met through their shared interest in the natural sciences. There was a the Boston Society of Natural History, to which my great-grandfather belonged, and it could be that Edward Everett Hale also belonged to that organization. In any case, I'm glad that my uncle's box of letters held some surprises for me, and that one of those surprises resulted in my standing here today to speak of two of my forefathers, one a literal forefather and one a religious forefather. Thank you.
Thank you, Denise. Our closing hymn today is number 121, We'll Build a Land. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4. If you are at home on Zoom, you'll find the words in your chat box. If you are here in the sanctuary, please rise as you are willing or able and join us in singing. Closing words are from Helen Keller, who was a distant relation to Edward Everett Hale. Everybody seems to have been related to each other back then. Mr. Hale has filled the old skins of dogma with the new wine of love and shown men what it is to believe, live, and be free. What he has taught, we have seen beautifully expressed in his own life, love of country, kindness to the least of his brethren, and a sincere desire to live upward and onward. He has been a prophet and an inspirer of men, and a mighty doer of the word, the friend of all his race. God bless him. Thank you.
try to take the time to let love grow. Don't ignore the sands of time. Just let a little love in yours and mine. Friends come and friends will go. The ones that last a lifetime savor so. Life goes on so sublime, but only if we stop and take some time. Every season, listen to the rhythm of the earth and sky. The
Well, this marks the end of our service today. Thank you again to our special musical guests, Bella Voce, and to Jeff Hamlin. Really appreciate your performances today. It was really a treat. Thank you, Denise, for his service today. We invite our congregants attending worship on Zoom to join us for a virtual Greet Your Neighbor coffee hour today and discuss the service theme and enjoy fellowship with other congregants. The link is in the chat box, and will be on a slide in just a moment. Those here in person are invited to join us outside on the deck for coffee or tea and fellowship. We're going to leave the chairs set up as they were at the beginning of the service, so no need to stack the chairs. And we hope that you'll use the chat box as a virtual receiving line to leave a message about the service today. Thank you for coming.